Gildan Media proudly presents Gildan Seminars, original lectures containing essential information that can be applied to every facet of life and business. Gildan Media presents Psychology of Winning for Women, a seminar by Denis Waitley.
All winners in life develop and actively think about a positive self-image. The scenes you portray in your imagination are often more than mere fantasies. Often they're previews of coming attractions in your life as surely as if you were looking into a crystal ball and forecasting your future. Just as the words of positive self-talk have a profound impact on your self-confidence and self-motivation, so does what you visualize in your mind's eye have a profound impact on your self-image and the achievement of your goals. You see, individuals don't behave in accordance with reality, but in accordance with their own learned virtual reality. Virtual because some of it's handed down as hearsay and secondhand experience from the past, and virtual because some of it is fantasy or premonition about something that has not actually occurred as yet or may never occur in the future. When you change your self-image, you change your outlook and your behavior, and thus alter your destiny.
My great-grandmother used to say, we shouldn't worry about scores on IQ tests. We should view our IQs as imagination quotients rather than a measure of intelligence. True vision is inner vision, an ability to convert past experience into positive input and to visualize a desired future. People who can do this become leaders, many also attaining great wealth. Storing every transaction as a learning opportunity, keeping their vision unclouded by negativity from past setbacks, they can see their missions clearly and describe them vividly. Visionaries who can see clearly what the future can look like attract resources, believers, and followers. What we imagine is what we become. Although the popular adage is, "Never cross a bridge until you come to it," the most successful people in our world have crossed those bridges in their imaginations long before they ever saw them. As Mary Richards says, the imagination equips us to perceive reality when it is not fully materialized. And what a wonderful reality that can be. At 14, Sandra Day O'Connor pondered a career in lawmaking while visiting state capitals during summer vacation. She became the first woman justice of the U.S. Supreme Court. A divorced grandmother from the inner city of Milwaukee saw herself leading her country, and Golda Meir became the first woman prime minister of Israel. At the age of 21, in her father's one-room flat over their grocery store, Maggie Thatcher dreamed of leading England. An awkward, nondescript girl in New York was totally obsessed with becoming a professional entertainer. She grew into Barbara Streisand. And the 20th of 21 children, she had a withered leg and couldn't walk without leg braces until she was 12. She became the first triple gold medalist in women's Olympic track history, the fastest woman in the world at the Rome Olympics, Wilma Rudolph. Without realizing it, we've developed a self-image concerning every talent we have, every sensitivity we show, and every action we perform. Listen to how people talk about themselves. I'm such a lousy cook, I can't even use the microwave oven. I have a great sense of humor. I have a terrible memory. I make smart business decisions. I'm a warm and sensitive person. I'll never get through that math class. When it comes to computers, I'm roadkill on the information superhighway. I can see it for you, but not for me. Whether we're aware of it or not, each of us is controlled by these mental pictures we form. We can't outgrow the limits we place on ourselves. All we can do is set new limits within which we must live. Let me repeat that because I want to be very sure you heard it, and you probably want to write it down in your journal. We can never outgrow the limits we place on ourselves. We can only set new limits within which we must live. Our self-image, which dwells at the subconscious level of thinking, determines the kind and scope of person we are in every walk of life. Although the term subconscious mind has been used, often inaccurately, by non-professional people, it's more correct to think of it not as a mind, but rather a level of awareness with very special characteristics and abilities.
Let's imagine two levels of thinking using the analogy of a money bank with a cardholder and an ATM machine. The cardholder is the conscious level of thinking. It's responsible for collecting information from all around us, storing it in our memory bank, and making rational decisions. And the ATM machine is the subconscious level of thinking, responsible for autonomic body control, such as breathing and heartbeat, and the storage of information and creative goal-seeking in long-term memory. Like your subconscious level of thinking in your brain, the ATM machine at your bank is programmed to perform a number of specific tasks. When the cardholder activates it by punching in the code, the machine does exactly what it's told to do. The human brain operates in much the same way, but is far more elegant and complex than any system we could ever invent. Compared to the human brain-mind system, the biggest supercomputer is like a speck of dust. Let's look at the relationship of the conscious cardholder level and the subconscious ATM level of thinking. The cardholder can't make a decision. We can't withdraw money, transfer funds, deposit, or get account information until we clear it with the ATM machine. The ATM checks its memory bank and then replays available data back to the cardholder for action. If you notice, this is one case where the machine controls the human. Unless the ATM gives you permission, you can't do anything. In the same way, our subconscious mind controls our conscious level of thinking. Action frequently takes place without consultation with the cardholder, but no action ever takes place without reference to the ATM. The information that's fed into your ATM memory bank stays there, waiting for you to retrieve it. You can never willfully erase the information. You are able to override it or modify it over a period of time, but like a notation on your credit history, you're virtually stuck with the information for years. Dad used to recite a poem about the self-image, and we grew up knowing it by heart. Deborah and I changed it to fit our analogy of the subconscious memory bank and the ATM machine. There's an automatic teller inside you and me, a subconscious bank statement of what we hear and see. It makes positive deposits of praise and love and cheer, and negative withdrawals of abuse and hate and fear. It doesn't care what's right or wrong, or what is false or true. It's a servant of all great leaders, and all the failures too. It's this automatic teller that builds your life success. It's the day-to-day deposits that lead to happiness. Be careful of the inputs and images you store. Be wise with your role models and the heroes you adore. It's this automatic teller that builds your life success. It's the day-to-day deposits that lead to happiness. Be careful of the inputs and images you store. Be wise with your role models and the heroes you adore. It's this automatic teller, the self-image that we hold, that takes the ore of compound thoughts and forges it to gold. Before you go to sleep tonight, feel how much you care. Be sure you know the value of the love you have to share. For there's nothing more important to the future that you'll live than the automatic teller and the deposits that you give.
The critical point to recognize, of course, is that both the unlimited potential of childhood and the tight constraints of adulthood originate and reside primarily in the imagination. It's time to reset the dream machine and adjust the dials in favor of towering growth and abundance. Dream is a really important word to remember. We've all heard the line from the song, "A dream is a wish your heart makes." Our longtime friend and motivational speaker, Zig Ziglar, says, "A goal is a dream with a deadline." From the time he was a young boy, Jim Carrey knew what he wanted to do with his life. At age 10, the comic actor of such hits as Ace Ventura, Pet Detective, and The Mask was making funny faces in the mirror at his home in Canada. Comedy was his inevitable path. Throughout his childhood, there were many bumpy roads. They lost their house and were forced to live in a camper, and later in a tent. When Jim turned 19 and wanted to pursue show business full-time, what did he have to lose? And besides, his father encouraged him to go after his dream. 3 years later, Jim Carrey was making money, but was unhappy, doing impressions in Las Vegas as a warm-up act. He finally convinced the club owner to let him try his comedy act, and he was an instant hit. 5 years before he became a movie star, Carrey wrote himself a check for $10 million and post-dated it, Thanksgiving 1995. Incredibly, his personal fortune grew to that amount during that time. "I wrote the check as an affirmation of everything I've learned," he said. "It wasn't about money. I knew if I was making that much, I'd be working with the best people using the best material. That's always been my dream. Better to risk starving than surrender. If you give up on your dream, what's left?" Set aside a section of your journal where you can let your imagination go without restraint and write down your wildest dreams. They may seem improbable at this moment in your life, but when you write them down, you give them credence and life. The poet Maya Angelou wrote, "If one is lucky, a solitary fantasy can totally transform 1 million realities." And the early feminist and social reformer Emma Goldman said, "When we cannot dream any longer, we die."
Here are some exercises to help you tap into the power of dreaming. First, find pictures that represent your dreams and goals and paste them in your journal. These can be pictures of the body you want to have, the trip you want to take, the house you want to live in, the outfit you want to buy. Keep looking at the pictures and visualizing yourself in them. This will help you internalize your dreams, making them real and attainable. Second, make it an important project to seek out and talk this week to someone who's currently doing what you want to do most. This applies whether you're talking about selling, managing, skiing, traveling, speaking, redecorating, or even being a good spouse or parent. The expert you're looking for may be next door, across town, or in another part of the country. Surf the net. Attend lectures and talk to the speaker afterward. Participate in courses at the adult learning centers, which are found in most major cities. Find courses to take from the extension program at your local university. Do whatever you need to find an expert and get the facts. Make a project of learning everything you can about other winners in your area of interest. As Eleanor Roosevelt said, "The future belongs to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams." Since your behavior or achievement level is usually consistent with your self-image, it will play a large part in how well you adapt to the new world. Your self-image operates much the way a thermostat controls the temperature in your house. You set the thermostat at 72 degrees, which is comfortable for you. When the temperature in the room dips below the setting, the thermostat automatically triggers the furnace to come on until 72 degrees is reached again. If the temperature gets too high, the furnace shuts off until the temperature again reaches your comfort zone of 72 degrees. It works the same way with a self-image and achievement. If you perform below your self-image level, you'll get uncomfortable and make an adjustment to do better next time. If you perform too well or too high above your self-image setting, tension will automatically bring your performance back down to where your imagination tells you you belong. This explains why some of us have temporary success and then sabotage ourselves because we start choking under pressure. In your journal, make some notes about your response to these questions. Do you view your self-image as your life handicap, or is it your achievement mechanism? Are you a lifetime slave to your ATM machine, or do you control the balance?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.